time for round six here at the Hearthstone Grand Prix. Got to adjust my headset. Sorry about that. Welcome back, everybody, from Jönköping, Sweden. It's time to continue on to see who is going to be eliminated here and who is going to move on to be undefeated. Only a certain amount of players remain undefeated. I'm going to see what's going to happen. My name is Frode. I'm joined by Nimsh and Lothar. The beginning team will close out the round six. How you doing, Nimsh?
I'm doing great, man. Like, I'm still like walking around, talking to players, watching them play. We have Ignite. I think he's playing on the last table, which is surprisingly table 69. And he's still waiting for Forsen. You know, he still has hope that Forsen will actually come and play his match.
Well, I read the tweet that Forsen's phone is on like 1% of battery, so he's probably not, you know, able to reach him.
He's not ready. I looked at the first tables. It's really intense still. I think like the first table we had Hoi versus RDU. They're playing right now. There's Protohype versus JJ. So a lot of players. Hannibal Z2, who is the winner of Cluj-Napoca, the DreamHack as well. He's playing versus Number Guy right now. So a lot of known players still fighting.
Yeah, we were talking about the beginning of the day. You said RDU, you think has potential to do really well, and you were bringing up Hoi as a potential candidate to really go far. And both these guys are matching up undefeated 5-0, and only one person will be undefeated at 9-0 by the end of the Swiss rounds. But it's really starting to come down to the exciting parts of the Swiss, of like the stories are really starting to shape themselves. One story that is really interesting is Darkwonix versus Zettelot, how both these guys are playing pretty wonky stuff, and yet they're here on the verge of elimination, both with a 3-2 score. Zettelot just lost to Orange, and Darkwonix managed to stay alive, beating Chucky.
Yeah, and now they are clashing against each other, so we're going to show that match exactly, and I'm excited. So the Shaman
Hope you're
player,
ready, man. Fatigue Priest versus Control Warrior.
I don't know if I'm ready, man. The Priest, like we talk about it in the interview. Yep. It's such a surprising deck. People are not prepared for that. And Shaman, on the other hand, from Darkwonix. Like, Darkwonix was the original Shaman player. He's always bringing Shaman to tournaments. And I don't even know what to make of it.
You know what? All of Shaman?
No, this matchup, like, overall, Shaman's Priest. Like, what is happening, Lothar?
I still want to see what kind of decklist is that Priest, you know? Because it depends so much of what will be happening in the matchups. Yeah. If that's a Control Priest, then it should wreck Shaman just with ease. Because that will be Okanai, Circles, Holy Novas, Light Bombs that will just clear off
Cabal Shadow Priest, guaranteed value always in the matchup.
Exactly. And then you can even take the Thunderbluff Valiant, which have immense value. But yeah, you know.
Crazy stuff going on. But we'll start things off with Shaman versus the Druid. This is the matchup that I think he wanted to see because he was talking about how Druids and Wards would be really common.
That's first appearance for Zettelot when it comes to LAN broadcast, right?
Yeah, I don't think we really see Zettelot compete very often, and when we do, it's a very rare occurrence to be held, so I'm really looking forward to see if we can pair it together, but seems like he's got a very natural starting hand here. He's got the Wild Growth, and then into the Shredder, and that's going to be really good. And I like that Darkwonix coined out the Totem Golem. A lot of people be like, well, you didn't do anything on turn two, but he really wants to kill the Darnassus Aspirin. I think that's one of the keys to the matchup.
Yeah, that's very true.
He also had the Rockbiter, so even if there is Aspirin, he can actually kill the Rockbiter and still have the good minion to contest other stuff.
Absolutely. The thing to keep in mind, too, is that as the matchup progresses, board tempo is going to matter so much for Shaman. Druid will naturally deliver the board, but they...
Oh my god.
That's such a bad result.
That's bad for Darkwonix, I think.
Of course.
Yeah. Sorry, I was casting perspective, like he just cast Rockbiter.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's a terrible result for Darkwonix because board control for Shaman is the most important thing to do. Especially in that kind of build, when you don't rely on spells to clear your opponent's board, right? Because you probably have like two Lightning Storms in the deck, but that's it. We saw one Crackle, so we can assume there will be a second one.
You mostly use minions.
But you have to use minions on that. You just lost a huge minion to a random drop. And dealing one damage, as announced a few years ago, will be a huge pain.
Yeah, no board. Like, he literally can't do it. But I'm looking at the Neptulan. Darkwonix was one of the players that tweeted early that Neptulan got buffed with the Murloc Knight.
Yeah, Murloc Knight is pretty awesome to get, but that's only if the matchup is long enough where you can get mileage off of the Murloc that you've given, a lot of times, in order to spend Neptilon effectively, you need like 20 mana or more, which is a lot of power, right? You think about all these minions that you're placing that might have synergy with each other. But I don't know if Druid's the matchup that you can get away playing Neptilon outside of just making a power card 7/7.
Probably not. But we'll see. The game is not over yet, even though it seems that deck one is pretty behind. So easy clear from Zetalot, just keeping the 4-1 cat. Even though it has only one health, it still deals 4 damage.
Yeah, certainly. And this is where having Lotheb is just good for stability onto the board. Having that healing wave is not really important now, but it might be later as well.
It will be at some point when he will like to get out of range of combo, but unfortunately for him, this is the turn when Druid is still in charge. Maybe even literally. We'll see what he will do.
Be in charge, yeah.
Wow.
That was pretty good, Lothar. I liked it.
Oh, the Nimsh approved my joke.
I do.
Dang, that you is get, quite you get a seal the points. Approval. Well, Healing Wave gonna draw out
and
Doctor. Wow, he's winning all of his jousts.
But not full potential, only 13.
I'm just looking at this hero power from Shaman, and it seems so bad overall. I just can't wait till we get the Murloc guy from the League of Explorers, when he can actually play it in Shaman and change the hero power to something useful. There's so much value from the shapeshift from Druid.
Yeah, but I think that's that Murloc will be available for most aggro decks, not for control decks. Because you just want to fish for Hunter hero power.
I have
hero
no
power,
time for games.
Power.
But as a shaman, you want to get
maybe
any hero power, which is not the totem creation. I must safeguard
the luck. Well, ends up just going straight back to work here.
Wouldn't you prefer to use 2 damage to the face from the keeper and 4 damage to the totem just to get it out of the way?
In the case where he has double flame tongue totem?
Even one is like kind of annoying.
You do have Sylvanas, so you might want to kind of steal the totem at some point because it is a minion.
Yeah, but this is a really good play. Being able to kill it and then hex the Sylvanas afterwards. Really, the board is
shrinking.
It's not that good. And Neptilon actually is such a huge power play over the coming turns. Something to consider, too, is that without that healing wave, Shaman would be at 13, and that's dangerous grounds to be in. But because Shaman has so much more health, Druid combo isn't as scary.
Yeah, but Druid is still a really dangerous deck, and Azurjake is going to provide some more cards.
Yeah, but you're Neptilon here for sure. Unless you just want better.
What is better than Neptilon? Dr. Boom.
No Haunted Creeper.
Dr. Boom. Yeah. Neptilon is 3 overloads, so you're going to be working at 5 mana next turn, so you can't even Murloc Knight hero power, but...
Oh, God.
He gets the Murloc. He gets the Murloc this turn.
He still might be able to draw 1 mana Murloc, which is...
And there is Murloc Knight, which is huge.
It's not playable next turn still, so he's gonna be reliant on the other minions, like Bluegill Warrior Charge.
Absolutely, but still, like, the Murloc Knight is really good because even if you play it 2 turns after, you do generate more cards.
So a card draw from the Wild Growth will go for Zetalot here, and he will most likely just follow it up with Dr. Boom. Clear. Wait, does it change anything?
That allows him a board clear.
Yeah, but do you want to do it right now? If you play Dr. Boom, use hero power, you can kill off the Flame Tongue and Totem and just leave the hex frog on board, because you always know that the only way to clear that frog from Neptune's way is a Lightning Storm or Fire Elemental.
Or Blue Gear Warrior.
Wait, Fire Elemental is not possible because you will have 9.
Well, Blue Gear is probably the best one here.
Actually, we have mana for Murloc Knight hero power.
Jules Scarab. And again, I have a flavor text for you guys.
Oh, you're right. For some reason, I was counting the 8 mana crystals immediately. So he does have it, but that's not the play at all. He has the Lightning Storm. And maybe Neptilon absorbs a lot of the Doombot damage.
And the whole bomb's killing him. Almost, I was so close.
Wow.
Oh my god.
Zeno is shaking his head.
So thumbs up.
Well,
feels
that
good,
worked.
Man.
That worked really well for him.
Wow.
Even hitting three of the Torison.
Neptalon's a champ, dude.
He took so much damage for the team.
Wow, but the pressure isn't going to stop anytime
soon.
Yeah,
it's not going away. The double force of nature, that's 12 damage coming from the hand. And like every single draw is closer to Severor.
I do want to say that the Lightning Storm also had to hit three on a pretty close.
Yeah, that's really, really big. So everything worked well for Darkwonix there.
Yeah. And then the Boom Bots hitting. That was so funny.
And now he has a Murloc Knight as well.
Murloc Knight, I mean, the most dangerous thing that come out of it is the
old Murkai.
And you can play another Murloc to make it a 4-4
yeah,
and kill the Drake. So that seems to be the best play. I mean, why not? Chain one good roll after another. Just ride this momentum.
Oh, he goes for Jules Scarab instead.
Oh my god, there's a hex.
He gets
a hex. That's so big. Now he hexes. And
hexes
he can develop.
Into Hunted Creeper or the Puddle Stomper?
Probably the Puddle Stomper.
Oh, interesting.
He still goes for it.
He knows he can't data combo.
Honestly, if there's something big like Ancient of Lore, you probably want to hex that instead.
Yeah, that makes sense. Or Druid the Claw or something getting in the way.
I mean, this is kind of awkward for him because the Force of Nature will clear the board with Keeper. So Darkwonix will be still in charge, will deal 4 damage to the face and develop a board because of the Keeper. So that's the perfect scenario for Zed.
I guess he'll use Hero Power instead.
Okay, makes sense. Yeah.
So you can use the Keeper to silence really threatening stuff.
Yeah, and you don't really have to kill everything. It's like one.
Well, yeah, two Flame Tongue Totems.
You won't be able to kill everything.
Yeah, exactly.
You want to hit face with 4. You don't want to kill everything. You kill off the totem, right? On the off chance that it's flame, not flame.
Thunder Bluff Valiant.
Agreed.
Defender Riders.
Ooh, that's a pretty good draw. So now, let's see. Hex. Okay, he's just going to Azure Drake first to get the draw out of the way. I think you still Hex here.
It's getting pretty dangerous for him.
Yeah, but you know that there's only
one force
left. However, if it got reduced in damage, it'd still die to a force nature Savage Roar, which is the very unfortunate thing.
Wouldn't you favor the Hunted Creeper instead of the Puddle Stomper? Because most likely the Druid will not trade anymore.
It's just more damage on board. I think it's fine.
And does the Savage
Roar. He was a couple cards off from lethal.
That'll be lethal, right? Because
yes.
Yeah, it'll be 19.
You would have Force of Nature, Savage Roar, which is 14,
Hero Power.
Plus the Hero Power and the 4 damage from the Darnassus Asper. So that would have been 19 tilted.
All right, but what do you do now? Do you just deal with? You can kill a
Wrath. I think you Wrath the minion. I just don't know if you Wrath the Puddle Stomper or you kill the Drake. Because a Drake with spell power is nothing to stop it.
I think I kind of would like to kill the 1-1 to protect your 5-5 from the minion attack.
Yeah, that does sound good on paper.
But then going for face makes sense as well. 2 damage is good.
Sure.
And you have 15 from the combo alone.
Now, this is a tricky turn, because you want to play Tasker Totemic, but at the same time, the placement might be very important. And...
Yeah, you place it to the left of the Drake. Or maybe... Yeah, maybe between the Drake and the Scarab, because if you get Flame Tongue, that's really good.
But you would like to trade both, right? So if you play on the left and you get Flame Tongue, then you trade with the Azure Drake first, and then you trade
with the Scarab.
With the Scarab to clear the board anyway.
Yeah.
So you can follow it up with Hunted Creeper, the Defender of Argus.
Yeah.
Well, he needs to think fast. He can also go with Double Creeper Defender and kill the 2-3. And then he has 2 good taunts.
Sure, that's also reasonable. And then
and the flame, there's a chance of getting the
healing totem.
No,
nice.
I mean the
golden gold. Oh, gotcha. That would have been pretty nice.
How much damage is it if he kills both of them? He loses 8 out of 14, so he has 6 left and 7 plus. That's 13, 14.
He can go for the silence this turn?
He's actually getting low as well. Like, you probably do not play around Bloodlust, even though Bloodlust was popular for a couple. I think last month mostly people played it. But there is a lot of minions.
Man, he's so close to lethal, but just not able to get it just yet.
It happens to Druid often, I feel like. Druid is just sitting on the combo and is really close, but then opponent is just keeping up. And if you get something like Vitality Totem from
it's Temp, true. This is such an important matchup for Dark Wanix as well, because he has Freeze Mage and Warrior. And if Druid gets past the Shaman, it is bad news for Dark Wanix. So he's really hoping that this pulls through.
Can he put him on lethal range with a Keeper and hero power?
He just keeps enough.
And he was, well, Healing Wave was already used.
Wow.
Well, he can have Tusker Totemic into Vitality Totem for the third time today.
Yeah. Is that the only out?
Well, it is.
10
literally
damage,
the only out.
6.
4. 5.
I wonder.
I guess that's the play.
That's
then.
Not enough for lethal.
Yeah, it's not.
With the Flanker, plus 4 is not enough. 4, 6.
He'll not
he
get
wouldn't
plus
even
four.
Get plus 4, because he only gets plus 2 since he only summoned the
Oh, yeah, right. Did you bring
some fish? Vitality Totem?
Not really.
That is really bad for Dark Wanix.
Well, he hopes there is no Keeper. But
well, not even just that, but it's like Swipe is possibility as well. So.
Alright, so it seems like Shaman is going to get healed.
Yep, and Zed'Alaw is able to take a very important game here, as now his Druid's won, Dark Wanix is going to have to pick the lesser of two evils here. He's got two decks that he doesn't want Druid to play.
That's true.
What was the mage deck?
From Dark Wanix, he plays the Druid mage.
Oh, okay.
But we don't know what Zed'Alaw plays when it comes to the mage.
Probably Freeze. It feels like he's a control style player. Although Tempo Mage would feel like it rounds the lineup pretty decently because it gives you more flexibility to like be aggressive and then be defensive with Priest.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It also could be one of those things where Zed'Alaw dedicates so much time to learning Priest that he might just pick things that are similar to it. And Freeze Mage does have an element of similarity.
It is. It is similar.
Like, keep the board clear.
I'll be
Don't
so
die.
Sad. I'll be so sad if Zed'Alaw actually wins 3-0 of the Druid. And we never see Priest. We really want to
yeah,
see Priest on stream.
We kind of put it up because I expected like some control Priest versus Fatigue
oh,
Warrior
God.
Mirrors. Like, not mirrors, sorry, matchups. And expecting like the Kalento and Strifecrow match of last stream Hack Winter, epic proportions. Because that was just nuts. It was like winning by 1 HP and going into Fatigue. And that was like the first time we saw Grinder Mage actually appear.
That was only because Strifecrow actually forgot to put winning conditions in his
yeah,
deck.
Yeah, he forgot to put Antonitis or something in his deck.
He like, just had minions.
Yeah, he just buffs. Had minions and he didn't put Antonitis in. So
this is some monkey business from Dark Wanix here.
Yeah. Fierce Monkey, I mean, that card is pretty versatile. Against Druid, it's a very good tool, too.
This card is bananas?
Yeah.
In some situations, yes.
I would consider keeping Fierce Monkey. Yeah. And
especially
Bastion.
If you have coin as well.
We opened the board.
Gore Howl. That's how you know it's fatigue. Like...
Well, he likes big cards. This is Dark Wanix.
It's a win. Gore Howl is a win condition in itself. I will run you out of threats and armor up.
This is a card that just decapitates Druid. You know?
Yeah, I don't know. I thought Gore Howl would definitely make a strong comeback with Justicar Trueheart, but it feels like people actually have still stayed away from it, feeling it's too slow.
There's a lot of weapons you can play. There is Double Fireworks, Death Spite, and it's hard to really let go. And play 5 weapons might be too much, but
you know,
I like it.
What's the dream with Gore Howl? It's the Mag... Is the Magcore Alpha? No, it's not that one. It's the... It's the something aspirant. it's like the Minotaur Aspen or something. You where mean, every you time you inspire,
three mana no, you mean that one plus one attack
yeah.
weapon?
Every time you inspire, it gives your weapon plus one attack.
That's the card that you.
So hypothetically, Gorehowl would be infinite value.
Wow. You're talking about the card that you only get from Portal, and when you get it, you're like, is Nux actually out?
No, I'm just talking about like how I thought TGT would be bigger impact with stuff like that, but it's not. Anyways, point being, Gorehowl is awesome, but maybe not in this matchup. Deathbite and Monkey are much stronger.
Well, Gorehowl should be good in this matchup as well, because Darkonic's going to get a lot of armor.
Yes, but he's also going to have his face bashed in. This is probably Innervate Thoris in play. I know it's not a very good Thoris in hand at all, but it's your best minion, and I would probably attack.
I agree. Yeah, you can attack with the Shade because Thorsten is a bigger target, and if the Shade actually gets hit by a coin Deathbite,
next four attack.
Yeah, absolutely. 8 damage is good.
And as Darkwanix, you are in a very tough position that you have to evaluate whether or not you want a coin Deathbite and accept all this damage.
I think you do. That might be the only play because you do kill the Shade now before it grows.
Yes.
And you kill Thorsten next turn. So
yeah, but you take an extra 9 damage by doing this.
Well, you have so much armor gain in your hand already with Bash and Shield Maiden.
True,
well.
But you're gonna go down to 10 HP next turn. Oh, sorry, with Druid of the Claw charge, you're gonna go down to 6 HP.
That is tough.
Would you just like Wrath your own minion for a better card? I actually might consider doing that.
Druid of the Claw should be fine.
Oh, you only can play one. Yeah, you can't play both. Never mind. Yeah,
there is
Druid of the Claw is better.
There is some merit to playing it as a taunt card as well.
Nah.
Because if you play it as a taunt, you protect your person.
But it's so much damage. Just maybe you win next turn with the Druid.
That's a interesting draw. Now you Bash and Shield Slam.
Yeah, and you can kill Thorsten as well after
now
that.
Now you can kill Thorsten afterwards. That's, I feel like that's really big.
Yeah, it is a great card.
Now you kill the Druid of the Claw and it didn't do damage.
So many choices.
Maybe you swing the favor back to your board.
Now, to be fair, you could still deal with the Druid of the Claw. It's not like it would live. You could just bash it and then Shield Slam the Darnassus Aspirant and then clear the board. So It could have been
maybe
a situation where Warrior would have less health, but the board would be completely clear.
Well, how can you do it?
How important will
I'm saying if he charged.
Aspirant.
If he charged,
oh,
he could
charge, yeah,
he
yeah.
would bash and then shield slam and then clear the board.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
it would
that's
have
true.
Been on 11 instead of 14. Sorry, yes, on 11. On 11.
Wait.
This is.
Stop that.
Why?
So he saved 1 HP by not attacking into Thorsten.
But this, he has no way of clearing the Emperor next turn.
Yes, that is very peculiar. I think he just didn't see the Bash Shield Slam play on the Druid of the Claw, right?
I think so, because that makes no sense, right?
You wouldn't want to leave Thorsten, because now you take that additional 5 damage anyways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, maybe he just knows that the next card will be executed.
Yeah, I think it's starting to, like, fatigue's really starting to settle in, man. These guys have been playing for, like, 8 hours already.
Also, it seems like the Darnassus Aspirant didn't have to die this turn, specifically because it's only 6 mana next turn, right? It wasn't 7.
Yeah. He's going to really need some help, like, execute off the top. Oh!
That's pretty good.
You
can actually answer Thorsten now.
Wow! Saved by the top of the deck.
Still not saved. 2 damage coming from the Keeper and 1 damage coming from the Hero Power means that Swipe effectively means ends the game.
Or yes. Second cat.
And he can Wrath
maybe
for a draw.
Can't he see that though? Because as you mentioned, Freddon, he might be fatigued at this point.
I'm sure he does. All right. It's a very... Because there's limited cards. Now, one of these things that you might argue is that if it's a hand of 10 cards, that might be hard. In this case, it's very clear what he needs to do. That is game.
Yeah,
so
that is game.
That's a 2-0 lead, and Darkwanix is big trouble. I think Zeta Lot might end up sweeping the series 2-0.
So if he would kill the Emperor the turn, how much damage would he do?
He would save. He would save four? 3 damage because the Tarn Assassin would still be alive and attacking. Mm-hmm. But he'd take one more because he took one less damage by hitting the Druid of the Claw. So he would net 2 HP, and Force of Nature ended up being 3 damage above lethal. Because he had 9 damage.
It would still be over.
With 7.
He was at 6 HP, right?
Yes, he took 9 damage. And he had 7 HP.
Oh, 7. Okay, so it's 2 over. So he would have died anyways. Yeah. Exactly. Because he net 2 HP.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So it didn't matter in the end.
It didn't matter in the end.
All right, so Freeze Mage versus Druid. A good matchup for the Druid overall because of the Shapeshift and all the nice tools. But we do have the torch, and we might have Reno Jackson as well. Have we seen Reno before from Dark One X? Like, whenever I see the torch, I'm thinking Reno Jackson is somewhere.
Oh,
there.
Wait. He actually might have lived. He would have played Fierce Monkey and Armor Up instead of Cool Task and BGH.
Oh, yeah, right. That would change that turn.
Yeah, he would have survived. He had Shield Maidens and stuff, right?
Yeah, he had
Shield Maidens.
So, like, yeah, he would have survived, now that I think about it.
We didn't think about changing the gameplay. After the turn.
Because he didn't armor up. That was a big thing.
Mm-hmm. Role play.
All right, well, Wild Growth is not what you want to see, but Dark Monarch at least has card draw, and he has Alex in the opening hand with Emperor Thorsen. And if there is... Well,
oh, my God. That's the same thing again.
Another game with Emperor off the intervene, and that is bad news.
Zendalot is, like, disgusted and happy at the same time.
So do you just double Frostbolt dead?
I think you... I don't know. I think you just... Arcane Intellect. Isn't it feel too disruptive to Frostbolt?
What about this play explosive?
Okay, you know what's hilarious about this? This Doomsayer can still be killed. 2 rats and hero power.
Oh god, this is really bad for Deck Onyx.
Yeah.
Although he is using 2 rats, they don't draw.
But he has an Azure Drake in the hand.
Yeah, it's a
for 3 mana.
It's actually 4 mana.
Well, next turn he means. When you double rat. Hmm.
So next turn he will have Azure Drake for free and Druid of the Claw for 4.
I was really thinking that Freeze Mage had a chance to win this game because you have the Thorsen and you had draw before it with Alex Straza, and that would have been a huge swing to basically pressure for a win.
Look at Darkwatix's face. He's like, well, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
Not like this.
It happens more often, and he might Frostbolt this again to stop the bleeding.
Maybe
if
cheap and ping is better.
Yeah, actually you're right. Cheap is better. Still doesn't feel good. And now the Azure Drake will continue.
A really
pressure.
Cheap Azure Drake.
And the Innervate is somewhat relevant because now you can Innervate and Druid the Claw charge. Oh, he's just going to go ahead and stop this? Okay. He's saving Azure Drake for a rainy day. This feels like he puts more damage out, but I don't know what he wants to save Innervate for specifically.
I agree.
Combo?
7? Did you achieve nothing?
Probably. It wouldn't even kill even if he had the ideal scenario of attacking twice. And he doesn't even have the Force Nature or Savage, so he can't Innervate combo.
That turn 7 is really good. And a Keeper, he can silence it.
Yeah, Keeper feels like, you know, now that Doomsayer 1 has been dealt with, it's okay.
Yeah.
I think you can play Emperor here, though.
You should. Definitely should, because that allows you to trade with the minion next in with whatever Druid plays, unless you just use Force of Nature.
And
it's still fine.
And it's not open yet. Druid doesn't have very good way to answer these right now outside of just trading a minion. That's not what you want to be doing. You want to be able to remove this with like swipe and then keep pushing.
That is a force of nature.
Yeah,
now you have
force.
Innervate plays. Okay. That's I don't mind.
That's a pretty good turn with the Shredder and using Forest to clear it. You probably want to keep the minions on the board.
Yeah. Because they make up the damage that you do by doing this.
But then still, like, a Flamestrike top deck might be very big.
Wow. Made the Azure Drake, so instead he wants to use the Force Nature Saboteur because he realizes he has 24 damage this way.
And he is actually playing around the AoEs because Flamestrike would actually destroy his board and leave him without anything.
Right.
And with this, he's actually having the possibility to combo. But yeah, look at that. There is a Flamestrike.
Dude, I mean, Dark Wanamas is starting to climb back a little bit in this game. He's not going to die to a Force Nature Saboteur now by playing the Ice Block.
And Druid is out of cards, so Dark Onyx might actually still win this, especially if there is something like Reno in the deck. But even with Reno, just freezes, damage.
Swipe is 10, 11 damage plus the 6 on board, 17. So 17 is max available. Not to mention that he doesn't know that it's Ice Barrier or Ice Block. So he's just going to take the very slow approach. And actually, I think you just aggressively Alex Straza here, and that might give Dark Onyx an opening to win this game.
Yeah, if he gets something like a torch, like some more burst.
Well, he used 2 Frostbolts, right?
Yeah, he used Frostbolts, but he still has torch, which he mulliganed before.
But Drake, the Alex Straza itself might survive.
Well, there's a Force of Nature and a Sword.
Yeah, but you don't do that. You just take the aggressive stance here. This is your chance to win.
Well, you do have to kill the Alex Straza.
Yeah, that's what I meant. I mean,
and that's trading more of your board. That's not hitting your face for 14
seconds. It gives mage time, but it's less time than just having an 8/8 dragon on the board.
Oh, that's a Savage Roar.
Does it do anything?
Not this turn, but
yes.
It alternates the plan. I think you should just swipe now and trade with the Pulse Shredder.
Yeah. To get a minion and go face with a 2/2. Yeah, that's reasonable. Unless you get a Doomsayer.
Yeah, or even just like a Noyotron or something, you know, like all these little damage pokes that come in here are really huge. The two damage off the swipe after it kills Alex Straza, or the 2 damage from the Keeper of the Grove, it all sets up like lethal.
Time waits for no one.
Is he just risking it right now?
What?
He is risking it. He says to Dark Onyx, you don't have any burn.
That's
okay.
How can you do that?
That's
okay, all right, okay. He's just saying, you know what, you don't have burn, but guess what?
He actually has nothing. The burn in his head.
Oh, no.
That was really weird, right?
Well, I mean, Zettelot played the aggressive line of, like, you have to have it, but
I appreciate it.
He completely had it.
So
okay, but let me ask you this. Zettelot had to deal lethal damage to break the ice next turn, and still clear the Alex Straza, because 2 attacks of Alex Straza were enough to kill him. So why not kill Alex Straza first? Because you will have to do it next turn anyway.
Maybe he's playing Chasm Mystic.
Well, I mean,
and you play around a lot of stuff. Okay, maybe Chasm Mystic, but
I mean,
that's the only possibility.
What if he had... Because like he used 2 Frostbolts, so Ice Lances are less likely to be activated, for sure. But what if he just had Pyroblast? And just like Pyroblast in the face, and then that's making Fireball possibly for lethal too.
I feel like he did this because he felt that he's not winning this game if he doesn't go aggressive.
It's very interesting to see. Now we finally came for the main show, ladies and gentlemen. That a lot new. He just wanted to show his Control Priest off.
Yeah, with
and he's
going
to queue it immediately into the Freeze Mage with Justicar True Heart in hand. And
which
I want to tell you,
you
do. Justicar True Heart makes it much better against Freeze Mage by a huge margin.
But yes. It's not like Warrior, because with Warrior you can go over 30 health, and with Freeze you do keep the max
true.
There.
But the key is post Alex Straza, because now you just save 1 heal with a 4 heal off the hero power, and you bounce up to... I don't know, 21?
21, 22.
22, maybe even more because of Light of the Naru and stuff. That allows you to stay alive for the burst, and all of a sudden, you just run. Freeze Mage doesn't have enough damage in 1 turn to kill you. They have enough damage, period, but you can out-heal it.
And Zedalon is playing so much Priest. He's streaming Priest a lot, and I think he's even better than Amaz at this point. Normally on stream he's playing so fast, like the priest plays that are complicated to normal people, like he just does them instantly.
Well, that wouldn't be. That's I don't think that's a very bold prediction. I think it's not a secret that Zelot plays a lot of priests, and these days Amaz keeps away from the play. Keeps away from the priests like it's the plague. Force next, but I think that priest overall is a pretty strong pick, specifically for slower matchups. And you know he has mind control in his priest deck. Wow, that's something that I wasn't expecting.
Well, he has Emperor for sure, right? So it will make a difference if you get two ticks from the Emperor.
No, are you
I'm
sure?
Just,
oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay, okay.
Just talking.
Gotcha.
You want like the nerf reversed?
Look at that. It ends up allowing him to draw a card because he played that. You know what? One of these things, too, is that Zed'Alot plays a very interesting, unique style of control priest. I know he also really liked Holy Champion for a while.
Mm-hmm.
That card is very, very good.
It's dangerous.
If it allows to live for one turn, which oftentimes Freeze Mage does because it just stalls the board.
Yeah, that's not a card you really have to get rid of.
It's like a more durable Frothing Berserker.
Yes, in many ways.
Darkwanix forcing a heal to protect.
And I think Zed'Alot will gladly take it because he gets to draw deeper into his deck for more answers as time goes on.
And so he forces a ping from Darkwanix.
I don't think so. He will just play the Power Shield, right?
Yeah, probably.
I mean, that depends if he is.
Maybe he's content with drawing cards. Listen, Zed'Alot's the priest master. I trust his opinion by now.
I mean, we have no idea what he has in his deck, and this totally affects the plays each turn.
What could happen is he saves Power Shield on a high damage minion, like even Justicar, for example, and it's safe for out of Flame Strike range. That's also one of the benefits of Power Word Shield in this matchup specifically.
So what's the strategy overall? Like, Frodo, you mentioned that it's good after Alexstrasza to heal back to like 20 plus and then just heal back.
Another strategy is legitimately to fatigue the mage, like make it run out of damage. And because, you know, Freeze Mage might just keep killing your minions.
But how can you do that when you can just burst, when your opponent just bursts you for 20?
Because the problem with the Freeze Mage is that it'll at best do like 15 damage in one turn, and then you can just keep healing back up with 4 per turn. Like, remember how big tank up is.
Yeah, but unless there will be a Emperor turn with Ice Lances.
Yeah, there is Ice Lances and Frostbolt already.
If you can kill in one turn, that would be huge.
And that's what we see right now, because there's Frostbolt, Ice Lance, and Alexstrasza in hand. So that's already 6 damage for 1 mana after the tick from the Emperor. So combine that with Fallnose, that's already 8 mana for 8 damage for 2 mana.
Perhaps.
And that's crazy. Right?
There's one other scenario as well. Like, he can literally get Doomsayer from Nova here, try to kill Deathlord, get Antonidas from Deathlord, and then cast like the small spells, get the fireballs, and after that play Thorison.
Something that happens in this matchup very rarely, but when it does, it's really awesome for the priest, is when you pull an Alexstrasza out of the deck for the Deathlord.
That's true.
Alright, so let's draw a couple cards here. And Zed'Alot still feeling pretty good so far. He has to at least be somewhat worried with how many cards you draw. Sometimes you draw too many cards as priest, and then the fatigue plan doesn't actually become that strong to play, but I think this is still okay, because Freeze Mage will draw a lot of cards too.
Actually, Alcanai with the True Heart can deal a lot of damage at some point. It's like 2 mana for damage.
Yeah? No kidding. 4 damage per hero powers is pretty nuts. But that is enough to kill if you use the Lights of the Naru.
He has double light of the Nar, right? So he can actually go double light and hero power.
So here's an interesting play. I think Cabal Shadow Priest might be okay against the Doomsayer, because you know that he has Alexstrasza for 8 mana. And this means that he can't develop Alexstrasza and keep Alexstrasza.
Okay, interesting.
So like, sure he can Alex, but his opponent will lose the Alex, and then he can play like Justicar and heal himself up.
To 19.
Because
he's missing one mana to make double
right.
heal.
But you lose the board, and you give your opponent a minion.
Yeah, the problem with this play, even though I do like it, is that it has Deathlord, and if your opponent like summons something of value, like
Acolyte of Pain.
Well, like Antonitis. He doesn't know Antonitis is in the hand, for example. But if
would
it did,
you like to get the Antonitis for your opponent because you have Shadow Ward Death in your hand, so you can clear it instantly?
Oh, yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah, and you get it on your.
I think that was actually the play because. If you get Alexstrasza, as you said, or Antonitis during your turn with your opponent
you're
having
right.
no reaction nope, time,
yeah.
right?
So it's you're playing for both of those things. Unfortunately,
yes.
for him, then Dark Onyx is holding both,
and it's gonna be a med scientist.
Dude, he's just gonna pass. I think there's justification of dropping Thanos here as well.
I don't think so. You need the burst with the cards you have in hand. That's so much damage for one mana. Just think about it. You're sure that you will have the 15 damage burst from Alexstrasza, and you will have 8 damage burst from just 3 cards that you have in your hand for 2 mana.
I have no
so
time
every single Fireball and Frostbolt from now on, there's insane amount of damage. Piling
I agree with Walthar. I think
okay.
Thanos matters, especially because Priest can heal up so much.
Well, it's an exaggeration of saying so much, but
it's a relevant thing. I like Sylvanas here too, because now if Dark Onyx develops a threat, Sylvanas not only can potentially steal it, and that gives him an opportunity to counterplay because he can Justicar heal afterwards. So this is 13 health remaining, and Zed'Alot will Shadow Word Death plus Light of the Naru heal, and that's a lot. Plus putting good pressure on the board.
When do you Justicar?
You Justicar on 10 mana so you can heal yourself twice. I think you Light of the Naru next turn. First, I think you kill the Loot Hoarder, Shadow Word Death your own Sylvanas, maybe? No, because then you're still vulnerable to Antonitis.
So if Zed'Alot doesn't heal enough, a single Fireball is finishing up the game.
He will, though. He knows exactly what Priest is capable of. And he knows what he can do with Emperor Thoris and played on a very big hand.
I wonder. And you need to keep the Shadow Ward Death, right? No. You can actually, you don't have to. Because you will mind control Antonitis, so you can Shadow Ward Death your own Sylvanas here.
But if you mind control Antonitis, you spend your turn. You spend your turn not healing, and you need to heal up. So I think you want to keep a Shadow Word Death for Antonitis. And
okay.
It's okay if the Alexstrasza is at 1 HP. The point is you dealt with it.
Okay, yeah, that's a fair point.
Also, with the Light Wardens right now, he's putting a lot of threats on board.
Yeah, I mean, that's 2-5 power minions, or 2-7 power, excuse me. I can't read. For some reason, I was like, he played Light of Naru at the same time, but you know, one buffed the other. So.
You can't chain it up.
Listen,
you know?
I have really bad vision.
Okay.
And this is the first day that I've ever played this game. Antonitis to get more damage with Frost Nova and Ice Lance. But is that enough? I don't know. I don't think it is. It's really close.
So
he needs Pyroblast. That's what it is. He needs it.
That's 50 damage, right?
He's going to death, and then he's going to heal. But he can't kill him the next turn, which means he Justicar double heals, and then that's six more health.
No, he Justicar this turn because he has coin. So Shadow Ward Death, coin Justicar, heal to 19.
Oh, yeah, that's
19.
Even better.
Well, sorry, 20.
Yeah, 20.
I don't know, but you get the Justicar heal twice next turn.
But
well,
I think it's more important to get it on the board
exactly.
right now.
Okay.
Like next turn you can heal for 4 again. So you kind of make up.
The outcome
for
is the same.
Yeah.
By the way, that's a lot of power on board.
That is at a bar, yeah.
That is handlock levels of power on board.
So you can't win yet. You have to flame strike.
Well, what if you fireball, ice block? Wait, fireball, ice block, frost nova. No, you have Doomsayer. So
you don't have enough burn in hand.
If you fireball, he drops down to 14, and then he heals up to 18, from what you know on board. So he'll be at 18, and then you can't deal 18 on one turn.
Yeah, just Frost Nova Doomsayer. Probably Fireball wants to face Hero Power. The problem is, if you take this really slow and like Ice Block, he's just gonna heal back up to 30 very quickly.
Where's the crazy alchemist when you need one, right? Oh. Well, but that's kind of similar,
I mean,
but it doesn't
he
really
doesn't have Holy Nova. He already used Holy Nova, unfortunately.
Yeah.
If he didn't, and he had Holy Nova with Vulgens, like, that is just ridiculous. But Bulger. I guess his board would be vulnerable too.
I mean, at this point, it doesn't really matter if he will have any kind of damage on the board, because the plan just now changed.
Yeah.
Now it will be fatigue war between mage,
right?
and priest.
Yeah.
That's what we're saying, man. That's actually a legit winning condition. Fatigue it. But then Reno Jackson changes
Reno
everything.
There
I actually
well.
Forgot about Reno Jackson being in the deck. That actually changes the fatigue battle completely.
Okay, so imagine if Reno Jackson would have been pulled out from the Deathlord.
Okay, now that's game changing.
There's also the torch as well, and torch is a lot of damage.
And probably a pyroblast. So, it's a lot of burn. Here's the thing. The reason why Reno Jackson changes a lot is it's not that he'll be able to out-heal the priest, but it's the fact that priest will take damage, and then you can burst immediately, versus priest can't burst you.
Yeah.
Usually in Fatigue Wars, you're reliant on the burst on draws, and so you're waiting for your opponent to take damage, but you can do, like, 12 immediately, so then he heals up. And that's the ultimate problem.
Oh, man, Reno Jackson is going to buy some time.
He will, and I think Darkwonix will be really scared to play Thanos now because of he realized that fatigue is a legitimate concern. And that might make Zed'Alot also a little bit worried. I want to know how many cards are remaining in each deck at this point.
You can go there and ask.
Acolyte of Pain is a dead draw at this point.
Well, you're not able to play it at any point of the game right now.
But
yeah, you might just Ice Barrier and gain life by doing it.
And so
you'd consider fireballing it.
I think Ping is not terrible.
He's playing the Acolyte of Pain.
This means like he is confident with the number of cards in his deck still.
Oh, maybe this is actually to deny him from playing Cabal Shadow Priest, because you can't load up the board anymore because you have to steal the Acolyte.
That's pretty smart.
So now it's like
hilarious.
Yeah. So it's like now you have to kill this Acolyte before you play the
Oh, wow! He threw a Pyromancer!
He has Pyromancer, so he can actually deal...
He can, like, Pyromancer, and then...
Seven cards in Zed'Alot's deck, and ten cards...
Oh, never mind. They're still pretty far. Zed'Alot's actually farther in the deck than...
Yeah, because
Dark
he was
Monarch.
Using Circle of Healing for the Cleric.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, the Cleric was used before. So this looks good for Darkwonix, at least, as far as Fatigue War goes.
So
wow.
Darkwonix is taking it. I'm sorry, Zed'Alot's taking it really slow. So he's not going to go for like some weird Pyromancer keep healing it shenanigans.
And Torch is like one more card because Torch gets back to the deck.
Yes.
Yeah.
It gets back to the deck.
It's 9 damage instead of 6. So, I mean, this Forgotten Torch ultimately is just going to be board control. Like, I think both these guys really have accepted that it's not going to be going to a battle of burst. It's gonna be a battle of attrition. And that hero power with Injured Blade Master is nasty. It's gonna force a fireball out of Darkwonix, and that's one less burst tool that he has.
Does it? I mean, there's a ice barrier still. And a second one. What do you care about this minion attacking you?
That's a good point. Yeah, maybe you're okay with just gaining 4 life instead of 8, right?
Okay, the window that's behind us shows a Kodos bottom right now.
Well, we are in Stormwind, get used to it.
Yeah, I think you fireball this thing, but maybe you feel.
I don't feel like that's at all necessary. Zed'Alot can't attack. Okay, maybe he did. But I mean, what would be the point to attack when your opponent can play second Ice Barrier because you know he didn't play one yet? And
you want to force him to fireball your minions.
Yeah, I think maybe there is merit to not attacking there.
Unless you have 8 attack on board already.
He used Doomsayers already as well, so it's not like you'd lose that damage.
And he used... Oh, he didn't use the Blank yet.
Yeah. Now he's keeping the control of the power on board, so that way Ice Barrier still gains some health effectively.
Mm-hmm.
And if... So I get it. So now he fireballs afterwards so that the health is sort of permanent.
But the Alcanine now is a great draw because you have an additional burst, 4 damage per turn. But the problem is, what do you do with your opponent if your opponent doesn't allow you to heal afterwards?
He knows his opponent has Flame Strike, so he doesn't want to like toss out the Alcanine.
So you might keep it for the final turns when it comes to fatigue, and your opponent might be on the brink of just killing himself with your fatigue damage. But you need that 4 points of damage that will come into the factor here, right? With the fatigue.
It's true. I do think that mind control might actually be useful to steal Reno Jackson.
It's some damage at some point. But it all comes down to how much fatigue the guys will get.
I mean, he's 3 cards ahead.
Well,
pretty significant fatigue.
He might be 2 cards ahead if the Death Lord dies, and there will be still a minion in the deck, but I think there's none left apart from 1 Novice Engineer.
If he plays it, yeah, because we haven't seen one. We've seen one with Horror, we've seen Mad Scientist. Is there a second Mad Scientist, maybe?
No, but the Scientist won't pull a secret. All the secrets are in the hand slash player right now.
And this is why I didn't like the attack from the priest, because
you have to go through it eventually.
You don't have to if you plan for the fatigue.
But he still has minions in his deck, I think. And you know what? I also think that Zedalot hasn't drawn his Confessor Paletris. I know he loves that card.
Is he playing it though? Like he loves Valen.
Interesting. Yeah, I mean he loves all priest cards. Let's be real.
That's true.
Also, playing Zombie Chow, you can argue, is probably not good for the fatigue plan. But as long as he gets Confessor Paletris, he still has an opportunity. And Zombie Chow number 2 is not it.
It's not great.
It could be a realistic substitution where he said, instead of Paletris, I have Mind Control.
So what's the last card then? Second Holy Nova?
No idea.
Have we seen a double already?
It could be the second Holy Nova.
So the deck forgot his wins condition.
No, Mind Control is
Mind Control
is sort
you
of a
steal
win
the
condition.
Win condition from your opponent. This is how Priest works.
I mean, Reno Jackson could also fight for the other side. By the way, funny thing. Reno Jackson actually kills you with Alcanine Soul Priest. If you get the battle right off. Just as a funny side note. Not that it would ever happen. But in this case, Dark Wannix can just keep stalling here.
This is still in a good spot.
I would argue that maybe you don't want to take the damage from Alcanine Soul Priest. I'm out of cards.
The last card
is Injured Blade Master number 2.
Oh, nice.
And now you can't really play Zombie Chow because of the fear of Flame Strike healing.
You can always kill your own Zombie Chow to 5 damage.
Dead draws for Dark Wannix.
That Reno Jackson is so important, like the more I look at it. Because you just get Mage to fatigue and they just die on their own turn. But with Reno Jackson, just getting a couple more turns would be so significant.
I love the fact that Dark Wannix has so patient with his Flame Strike. He knows that there's probably a minion in his deck, so he doesn't want to kill the Death Lord just yet. So he's going to probably Flame Strike and not ping the Death Lord. Oh, is he going to ping the Death Lord?
Well, that means he doesn't have a minion in it.
Oh, man.
That was the second Mad Scientist.
So now he accelerates himself by 1 turn of fatigue. And, I mean, Zedalot can still heal this injured Blade Master because he's going to take 2 fatigue and that'll still be offset by his hero power.
But he's already ahead and Reno Jackson is huge amount of heal. Like
Yeah, it is a lot and he can also deal with the
first 7. I don't know, man. Reno is it's so early for Reno.
He's not doing it. Yeah, he just wanted to cast Fireball.
I don't know. I feel like he's so even with fatigue because if you really think about it, Priest Hero Power is resetting fatigue by 4. He's really at +2 fatigue.
How much damage is it though with like Roaring Torch? Torch is 6, right?
Torch is a Fireball basically.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
1.
Whoa, he mind controls now! Because he thinks that might be his biggest minion, but he's not anticipating Reno Jackson. Dark Wannix is like, oh yeah, sure you have mind control.
That's pretty
good.
You can
take it 2-2. Oh man, he might have played his card a little too early there.
That's
I think he thinks that might be his last minion outside of Thanos.
He can horrible mad scientist.
That's what he's doing. He's taking it.
Mad
all
scientist
the way.
Was so clutch at the end.
It's like, how many fireballs do you have?
16 mana to kill a mad scientist. That's a lot.
And now
that
he has to play Zombie Chow.
MVP.
Zombie Chow's gonna heal, but it also does damage. So he might fireball the Zombie Chow, then play
That's
Reno
a torch,
Jackson.
Man. That's a torch.
Dude, I think Dark Wonix just won this game because Zenilot played his mind control way too early.
Yeah, and Reno Jackson's gonna be great. More attack.
I think Zenilot is just not. He just didn't think about the Reno Jackson because.
That's right.
Like,
he hasn't gotten
no
hints.
Novice engineer.
He hasn't gotten
hints.
No novice.
Engineer.
Yeah. There's no like cold light oracle to kind of like
he saw
split.
The torch.
No roaring torch. He didn't see the torch.
He saw the torch. There's the roaring
torch.
Oh
yeah,
right.
Yeah, you're right.
And Dark Wonix can play this game too, I think, because he can also play the burst damage game. He's got two fireballs and Thanos, so that's an extra 14 damage. Although. I mean, the Reno Jackson is just such a big deal. Like, he can wait another turn here. In fact, he can wait
two more turns
before Reno Jackson.
And then he gets three more turns.
And then Zenilot's taking six damage next turn.
But Dark Wonix didn't see a second Holy Nova, so he might think that it'll be... No, he would have seen that on the mad side.
He would have seen it on the... Yeah, that turn where he had the opportunity to kill instead of Light Bomb. And Zenilot did have an answer to Mad Scientist. He could have just Light Bombed and passed.
That's true.
Reno Jackson!
Oh,
man!
And Zenilot is, no,
and
not like this.
Realizes, wow, crap, it has four attack.
How do you deal with this?
Six health, you have to Light Bomb and Zombie Chow.
Zombie Chow to contest it.
And
I
that's
think
it.
That's winnable.
That's it, because now Dark, he's going to take fatigue damage for seven next turn, no
and
matter what.
Reno Jackson will attack.
And then he's going to fireball, he's going to fireball Roaring Torch, and that's it, that's game.
Okay, but real talk now. It would not matter at all with the mind control.
Shut up, Luthor! This game was epic! That was so sick!
On the back of Reno Jackson, their Dark Wonix takes it and stays live.
Sorry, I'm not trying to be rude, man, but that was just really crazy.
It was a crazy game, but I want to just point it out that the Reno Jackson, like the mind control in Reno Jackson, wouldn't be mattering at all because Dark Wonix could have timed it out to the point where Priest couldn't heal the same turn, so it would have been killed by the fatigue. No, next turn.
Yeah,
and
that's it.
He would have
fireballed
twice,
damage.
And then fatigue would have killed.
Even the like with the torch is like 18 damage on one turn plus fatigue.
So I guess that if you think about it, then mind controlling the scientist was the best play. Though.
Yes, probably yes. I mean, not probably. It was the best.
It was the best play. In what world is that the best?
Well, he never played a Chow. That was another thing too. But that's because he didn't want to heal his opponent, because he knew his opponent had the Roaring Torches. But if he used Roaring Torch or Fireball on the Chow, then he loses that burst damage for the turn, right?
Yeah, but.
And then Mage was taking a lot of damage too. It only had three turns, so the Reno Jackson might have been relevant if he played Zombie Chow more aggressively and forced the Fireball out.
I think Dark Wonix still had it in the bag. Like, he was really ahead in the fatigue race. And now we are gonna see the last match of the series.
Tempo Mage
with Ronin.
Ronin is pretty awesome against Freeze Mage. But generally speaking, Freeze Mage can stop the aggression very easily. The only thing that is really empowering the Tempo Mage is very quick starts with Mana Worm, Flame Waker's hitting a lot and getting a lot of activations off its abilities.
And Freeze Mage missing the removals, and then like Tempo Mage having Fireball and ping for Doomsayer at some point.
Interesting.
But yeah, I think it favors Freeze Mage actually.
Man.
Crazy series, I would say. Crazy.
It was. I mean, I just didn't want you to ruin the game with smart analysis for me. I was like, nah, it's crazy. But, you know, you're totally right, Lothar. I think in the end, it was inevitable based off the sequence of plays. And that's such a hard thing to accept because we see the cards and it's like, well, it just mind control Reno, man.
Yeah.
But that's not how it works. And I guess in that instance, he really misses the Ysera or Confessor Paletris split that you usually make on the Control Priest.
It's hard to say if Paletris would change a lot. Depends on the legendary, but.
Well, imagine Grommash, imagine Ysera, imagine.
At the last moment?
Yeah.
Sneasel Shredder.
Sneasel Shredder would be nice, and what else would be nice? Is there a legendary that heals you every single turn?
You can... Nah, not really.
No, but there's a legendary that it makes you immune.
Yeah, that one.
It's pretty good.
Yeah, but it eats a fireball and dies.
Yeah, so it gains you 7 health.
Okay, you can get another one next turn.
Yeah, that's true. And you can also get Kael'thasa'd, which keeps Confessor Paltrus alive forever.
And you can get multiple Morganas too.
Yeah, you can. Alright, so Darkwonix has some anti-aggro tools. You can Frost Nova Doomsayer now and treat that very seriously. The problem is if his opponent fireballs and it kills off that Doomsayer.
Actually, double Frostbolt might do it as well.
I mean, you can fireball the... You can also fireball the Flame Waker if you want to treat it very seriously and just be like, I don't even want to give you the chance of answering this Doomsayer.
The Doomsayer is good to a point that you actually block next turn as well. So you hope there is no fireball, but even with fireball, it's just a chance that will kill the Doomsayer.
However, the Doomsayer will get answered. There's two Frostbolts in the hand from Zed'Alog.
You can still get really unlucky.
Oh my god.
If you double,
I think you go for it.
Yes, I think you do. Mana Vorm into double Frostbolt.
Yeah, it's a great chance. It's like four hits.
What are the chances that it misses?
1 to 16.
Four times. 1 out of 16. I'll take it any day of the week.
But it can happen still that he misses.
Yeah, yeah, and he's like, okay, here's a fireball, but no, it's a Frostbolt, and just has to hit once. There it is.
You got it.
And that's perfect. So that way he gets 2 damage right afterwards.
The face. It buffs both worms.
And that's scary news for Darkwonix.
There is Cone of Cold, but then there's no follow-up, right? Like, you need something.
Ice Barrier stalls the damage on the board by one turn. So it's kinda okay, but...
You might actually go for Ice Barrier Mad Scientist?
I think that's correct. Perhaps. Like, you need that minion on board right now. And Ice Barrier just stall a little bit. You might also think about Mad Scientist and Frostbolt.
What about Ice Block Mad Scientist? Like, because then you ensure Ice Barrier from Mad Scientist, and then you have a second Ice Barrier. Kind of like, that's not bad as well.
And the problem is, like, you can't really kill Flame Waker, but at the same time, you know that your opponent is probably out of spells. He might have, like, a fireball.
But he can just pick up Arcane Intellect, and the entire problem restarts.
Counterspell.
Yeah, Counterspell's really nasty.
It's really good, exactly.
My god.
He has 6 mana, so he'll be able to cast both Flame Waker and Counterspell. And Counterspell mostly hits something like a Blizzard.
And he has a good chance of killing the Scientist as well. With the
4 hits? Corners.
Yeah, but I guess you could take the really safe approach and kill it beforehand.
I think 4 hits is really good.
Because you don't want to overkill it, but I guess it's fine. Ultimately, because you just want the Mana Worm to be protected. The Mana Worm's like the most valuable asset here, I think. What? Major balls? That sequencing was very interesting. Because the thing is, if you didn't kill...
Torrison?
Oh god, you can't play that. I mean, Darkwonix has no idea that this is a counter spell. He must have to think that it's... No, wait. Why would you play a Mirror Entity against a Freeze Mage when there might be a second Doomsayer just to lose the game?
Yeah.
That's like... You
probably wouldn't. Well, that's a lot of damage, actually.
But so he also thinks he might just die. And that counterspell!
And he's like, yeah, that was a counterspell.
I mean, wasn't it just correct to play the Emperor?
I mean, even if it is Mirror Entity, he played one Doomsayer, and the second is that he buffs his minions and get damage from it. He got five damage from that counterspell.
And it's much more likely it's Mirror Entity.
Big time.
Based on my god.
That's eight.
That's it.
Eight damage.
That's the pop,
nine
right?
Damage. That's 9 damage just from the single Archon missiles.
That's just so crazy.
13, 17 damage.
Seems like Darkwonix is getting Arcane shots.
Yeah, so this Arcane gets 4 damage plus eight. And then.
And plus 1 to the worm.
So it's nine damage Arcane missiles.
9 damage for 1 mana.
Pretty sick.
That's a lot of damage.
Wow.
And now he can.
And Darkwonix does not have a direct heal. He has Ice Barrier and Ice Block.
However, he made a small misplay by not synchronizing the attacks correctly, so he could have set up his opponent at 1 HP.
With the Mana Worm attack for...
First, because first, he missed one attack with the with one of the Flame Wakers.
Yeah, that's true. And that might make
that
a difference.
That would have been a difference if he had Flame Strike.
Yes.
Yeah.
And Flame Strike only, but Dark Wanix doesn't have it. He has Ice Barrier, Ice Block. He has to Ice Block for sure. I think you... The problem is Ice Barrier would never be relevant at this point because your opponent will make sure that Ice Block's popped with 1 HP.
Interesting.
And then actually he will go down to 1 health and he will not have the heal unless he's playing Healbot. But even with Healbot, he's not responding to the board, so this will be extremely difficult for him.
All right, well, Judgment Day. This is basically the last turn your opponent can do something.
And there are Arcane Missiles.
You don't really even need that.
No, you don't need anything.
Would you play Ronin on the off chance your opponent kills your board?
To get even more Arcane Missiles?
Yeah, because you can pop them at one now.
Yeah.
Wait, hold on.
Yeah, you can.
Easily. I was just trying to count to make sure. And then you just play Ronin.
Makes sense.
The Might of Dalaran!
Hello!
That's a War Golem.
No, it's a bit better. Come on.
It's a War Golem with two helmets.
So Dark Onyx, he can Frostbolt his own face. He can Fireball his own face.
No, I mean, he can just go out gloriously and let his opponent play missiles for victory. That was a good run, but looks like Zenilot has stays alive in the tournament and will exit round six with a 4-2 record.
And the Rocks will have three losses, so he will not be able to make top 16, but that was a good run. Medivh
that was a
going
really
down.
Good series.
Yeah,
yeah, really fun
intense.
Stuff overall, but it looks like the Viking has fallen, and Zenilot will prevail. So the Priest stays alive with some really crazy shenanigans going back and forth. Really fun series.
Absolutely. Yeah. And we've seen the Reno deck again. So the Freeze Mage with Reno. And we've seen some Shaman shenanigans. Neptulon. That was pretty fun.
It was. Yeah, that Shaman deck from Dark Wanox ended up winning its games. It didn't actually underperform it. Yeah. And it won with like the kind of style that people were anticipating Shaman to be good with in the first place. Mm-hmm. With like all those TGT cards you were talking about. So looks like, you know, maybe some people's opinions might change if you can line it up correctly for the good matchups, like good against Druid, good against Control Warrior. Maybe it also has some other pockets that we're not thinking about.
It might be just a viable deck for all us heroes standing.
Yeah, that's specifically it, because you can make sure that you line up its matchups correctly. But if you're always playing Paladin, if you're always playing against Freeze Mage, if you're always playing up against, like, Aggro Hunter, you're going to have a bad time.
Pimpico is so happy right now.
There's so many weird
or Patron
matches.
Warrior.
Oh, God, stop it. It's just like like half of the metagame now.
Yeah.
Even more.
Is it actually good?
Well,
is it the case?
Look, it's not a bad deck. It's just weak for the decks that are good in the metagame. The decks that are the best, it just naturally preys on Shaman.
But the thing is, like, people do not playtest against it. Yeah. There's no point. It's so bad, right?
Here's the thing. The TGT cards are actually good. Totem Golem's fantastic.
Yeah.
Thunderbolt Valiant.
Totemic
good.
Is good as well.
Tuskcraft Totemic is great. It's just Shaman is the problem.
The hero power, maybe, is, like, not powerful enough. Especially if you actually want to play the totems as totem cards.
Yeah. No, I think there's another problem we didn't mention. Overload. Overload mechanic makes it awkward to play the class as a whole. And,
Well, that's what the Trog is for, right?
Yeah, so that you can actually get advantage
with an aggressive deck. Stop hating, guys.
Get the Murloc to change the hero power, and then we can actually play Shaman with Hunter's hero power or whatever.
Just play the charged hammer and get the jolt for 2 damage.
Doesn't work.
Yeah. But looks like we're going to sit down with Zenilot and chat with him for a little bit after that interview, winning 3-2 against Dark Wanda. It's going to distance, but we get a chance to sit down with the Priestmaster himself. So Zenilot, How's it going, man? How are you feeling after that match?
Yeah, I feel pretty good, I guess. But I kind of misplayed the mage games. I mean, his mage.
Oh, okay.
I thought it's Echo of Medivh at first because I saw the explosive ship.
Oh, right. Okay.
But
yeah.
Then I realized it's Freeze Mage and then Reno and like.
Well, you learned very late that.
Yeah,
Reno.
That was weird.
You didn't expect Reno at all in the end?
I did because he was writing cards on the
oh,
paper.
Oh, okay.
So
okay.
After he was playing a card and not after you were playing a card. Might have,
yeah,
you know.
Keeping track of you know, what he's playing and whatnot. Yeah.
What about like mind controlling mad scientist?
Yeah, I was like, I have to do something because I'm gonna lose. So
yeah, and I mean, it's pretty hard to. I don't know how, if you're keeping track of how much burn he had in his hand to remove your threats
yep.
or to kill you. But you were doing it, and then he was on that turn. The turn before the final play happened, he was on the turn to kill you anyway with two fireballs,
yeah.
And then you would have taken fatigue damage. So yeah. Tough really tough matchup, but you pushed it to the edge. I mean,
yeah,
Priest is
he went for fatigue. If I knew he's gonna go for fatigue before, I mean earlier, maybe I could have do something.
Yeah.
But I thought he's like full burst, and I have to heal myself all the time to survive.
Yeah, I wasn't sure if you were worried about like a pyroblast and other stuff like that, because that if so, then healing yourself every turn would have been absolutely correct, because you need to make sure he can't burst you down one turn. With Thorzen activating on like six spells,
bad news. I have to do something.
Yeah. Okay. Fair enough. How are you feeling about competing? You know, in DreamHack, people don't really see you competing that often. They see you streaming. What's that been like for you?
Well, it's cool. I like being here.
But I just wanted to note that you're sitting with three Polish people.
Yeah, we can actually interview him in Polish, you know?
Oh, okay, yeah. So go ahead and conduct the interview how you wish.
That would be really rude for the viewers. There's like 5% of people watching in Polish.
Okay. We should have Frodon interviews that a lot in Polish.
That will not go well.
You
that'll probably go as, you know, as well as me competing in this tournament.
You should definitely Polish your Polish.
Yeah. It's Polish, my Polish, but yes. Is that a lot? Quick question: are you going to be competing more regularly at all, or do you think this is just kind of a one-off thing because it's DreamHack's a big event?
No, I think I will. It kind of depends. Mm-hmm. With next week, Priest is going to be broken again.
Oh,
so
in two?
Ooh. Yeah.
Ah, I love it, man. It's good. You're getting the prediction from the Priest man himself.
What is the card you're looking for?
Entomb.
Yeah, Entomb. Exactly.
Yeah, I love the card. It's really well designed. It's unique in our game here.
Yeah, people will stop playing Warrior because. You can't win with Warrior again against Priest, I think.
Oh, wow.
I mean, not in Fatigue, at least. You can beat Priest with Grommash, I guess, but in Fatigue War, no way.
Are you not satisfied about Excavated Evil?
Yeah, I played a bit with this. I played, like, Excavated Evil and, like, 10 Legendaries, and I was trying to survive and then play Legendaries, but, yeah, it doesn't work that well.
Mm. But it's good that you actually tested the card, because then you can have a good opinion on it.
Where do you think Priest currently sits after League of Explorers, because people are still considering it like bottom tier, the bottom third of classes? Do you consider it around there, or do you think it's higher and people just underestimate it because it's a harder class?
It's a bit better, I guess, but we are still waiting for this Entomb and Museum Curator.
Okay.
So
you like that two drop?
Yeah,
thing.
I was.
People
I mean,
were like
to ask about
kind
it.
Of
I mean,
dumping on it.
And it kind of depends, I guess. Like, I have to test with it. But Entomb, I'm sure it's going to be good.
Okay, cool. Fair enough. Well, we don't want to take too much of your time. Do you guys have any last questions to toss?
No, I think we would like to start with the last round of the day, right?
So yeah, I think we're going to wrap up because it's been a long day. Do you have any final words before we let you go?
Thanks for watching.
You heard it here. So we're going to go to a break, guys. And when we come back, we're going to have the final round of the Day 1 Swiss here at the DreamHack Winter Grand Prix. Stay tuned.